Ever wonder how the dinosaurs came to rule the terrestrial realm of Earth? Ironically, it was a mass extinction event, specifically the late Triassic mass extinction. This extinction event was the fourth of the big five Phanerozoic mass extinctions, as shown here on this diversity chart. It devastated marine life but completely transformed the terrestrial realm. And that's largely because dinosaurs actually benefited from this event. They were able to radiate and dominate after the Triassic extinctions because so many of their land animal competitors went extinct, or at least nearly vanished. And I'll talk about that later in this video, but I also go more into depth of why dinosaurs were so successful and kind of debunking some dinosaur misconceptions in a separate video. And if that's out by now, I'll link it to the top right. But now getting to what organisms went extinct or were devastated during this extinction event, and later we'll talk about what caused the extinction event, what climatic and environmental changes, and then we'll talk a little bit about why the dinosaurs were so successful throughout and after this event, and what other organisms also survived the event and lived throughout the rest of the Mesozoic era. So, as we can see here, unfortunately, the conodonts, or these little tiny worm-like fish that had these teeth that were preserved in the rock record, those guys, which were great index fossils for the time intervals that they did live in, went extinct. And also, placodonts, these huge armored marine reptiles, went extinct at this boundary. However, as you can see in this image down to the bottom right, there's a plesiosaur back here that kind of looks like a Loch Ness monster. Those guys survived the extinction and lived in Mesozoic seas after that event. And then we had reef-building corals and sponges, thankfully not go completely extinct, but they were very much devastated to the point of near disappearance. And then ammonoids, which we can see also swimming around here in this picture, were actually declining before the event happened and therefore weren't hit as hard and recovered and rediversified after the fact. On land, we see a complete transformation. Almost half of all vertebrates on land went extinct during this extinction event. Large amphibians, as well as therapsids, as shown in this picture, were hit the hardest. And because they were pretty much the major competitors with dinosaurs during the Triassic period, once they had been majorly declined after this event during the Jurassic, dinosaurs completely took over. And not only did dinosaurs rediversify after the extinction event, they also fared better throughout the event. They survived in large numbers, and of course, like I just mentioned, thrived afterwards. The thriving afterwards part makes a lot of sense because their competitors were gone, but why they survived in such large numbers is for a multitude of reasons that we'll discuss later. But first, let's talk a little bit about what was going on tectonically during this time period and what that might have caused climatically that would have caused a mass extinction event. So, sediment deposited in fault-blocked basins in North America during the separation of Pangea tell a story of this extinction event. Pollen and spores preserved in these rocks indicate that most sea plants died and that ferns kind of took over for a brief interval. Strata in Morocco show a similar pattern. And vertebrate fossils indicate the disappearance of therapsids at the same time that the ferns took over. After this event, in rock layers above the fern expansion rock layers, there was a small variety of animals, mostly dinosaurs, that occupied land, aka most of the other animals were gone. Terrestrial fauna were hit so hard because they had no buffer to atmospheric temperature variations like animals have in the ocean. Terrestrial flora were also hit very hard, but recovered more quickly than the fauna. The slow or lack of recovery of terrestrial fauna was likely due to the dinosaurs' dominance. Because they were so dominant, they kind of kept other terrestrial fauna, other terrestrial animals, from rediversifying and becoming big and dominant. And one of those types of animals that was kept small and prey-like throughout the entire Mesozoic era because of the dominance of dinosaurs were mammals. And that's why, until the Cenozoic era, once the dinosaurs had disappeared, mammals couldn't enlarge and diversify and become dominant and rule the lands. But what was it that set off this extinction event in the late Triassic in the first place? The Triassic extinctions coincide with a period of great magmatic activity as Pangea began separating. So recall that Pangea was the supercontinent that formed when all the continental masses came together at the end of the Permian period, at the end of the Paleozoic era. That was just before the Triassic period. So in the late Triassic period, Pangea began to rift or separate apart at its center in this red region here. And normal faults, because of this rifting, began to form because as rock separates or undergoes extensional stress, the rocks break and some blocks of rock that then break off from another block of rock will drop down. And that's called a normal fault, where one block drops down. And a lot of these normal faults were causing, you know, the fault-blocked basins to form. But a major thing that was going on is they were allowing magma to rise up through them. Because remember, these are cracks in the rock. And so really expansive dikes and sills and flood basalts formed in what's called camp, or the Central Atlantic Magmatic Pronvince that's shown in this red region here. And all of this activity was going on right at the Triassic to Jurassic boundary from around 205 million years ago to around 191 million years ago. The camp volcanism actually rivaled the Siberian Traps for being the largest province of continental basalts to ever form on Earth. And the Siberian Traps, if you don't know, represent volcanism that occurred at the end Permian that caused or contributed to causing the largest extinction event of all time, the Great Dying. I have a whole video about the Great Dying that I'll link up to the top right if you want to check it out. And we don't even know the full extent of the camp volcanism because erosion has eroded a bunch of it away. So it's one of the largest basaltic provinces on Earth, and we still don't even know if that was its full extent. So what this volcanism caused was the release of a bunch of CO2, both because it's volatile in magma and becomes released as magma rises and then explodes out of the earth, but also due to the burning of carbon deposits that it was emplaced into, the magma was emplaced into. I wanted to specify that because I talked about how volcanism of the Siberian Traps released a lot of carbon in the Permian in my Great Dying video, but a lot of you pointed out that it also was being emplaced into really carbonaceous deposits, and it burned those as well, causing even more carbon dioxide to be released. So this happens pretty much any time volcanism occurs, but I think for the Siberian Traps and the Permian, it was especially extensive that it was burning deposits of carbon, and that's why that extinction event was so large. And that spike in carbon dioxide, as you can see on this carbon dioxide graph here, was so crazy. In fact, the Triassic extinction looks like a little blip compared to the Permian extinction here in terms of carbon dioxide levels. But you can see here still quite an increase in carbon dioxide. It doesn't look as much like a big peak because it didn't go as far down or decrease as much after the Triassic extinction, but the increase was quite substantial. And we can quantify this increase because we can count stomates or stomata of fossil leaves. Stomates are cells in plants that take up CO2 for the plant to use. And when CO2 concentrations are increasing and super abundant in the atmosphere, the concentrations of stomates decrease because they don't need as many to take up CO2 if it's really readily available. The estimates of CO2 increase based on this method indicate that they increased from around 2 times modern levels to around 7 to 8 times modern levels of atmospheric CO2. This increase in CO2 would imply about a 3 to 4 degrees Celsius increase in atmospheric temperature at the end of the Triassic. Negative oxygen and carbon isotope excursions in the ocean and atmosphere at this time corroborate the CO2 increase and this warming event. The sudden warming would have caused the extinctions at the time, not only because of warming of the ocean, which a lot of organisms such as reefs, which are really important for major ecosystems in the ocean, can't handle and therefore go extinct, but the warming wasn't the only thing that caused the extinctions directly. Ocean anoxia also is a consequence of warming and increased CO2 levels because warming causes an ocean to become more stratified or stagnant, not as well mixed, because cold waters drive down oxygen to the deep waters. And if you don't have as cold of waters, you get a stagnant ocean, a non-mixed ocean, and you get anoxia or lack of oxygen in the bottom part of the ocean. The other thing that would have contributed to ocean anoxia was phytoplankton blooms, because an increase in CO2 increases photosynthetic blooms at the surface of the ocean, and those also contribute to ocean anoxia because they produce organic carbon at such a high rate that the decomposers at the bottom of the ocean that are decomposing all that organic matter use up all the oxygen to do so. Many animals were unable to cope with this raise in temperature, as well as ocean anoxia, and terrestrial herbivores also suffered major losses of food source because many of the plants they eat died out across large regions. The dinosaurs, however, like I mentioned, were not hit very hard and thrived after the event. The one major reason why they thrived afterwards was pretty simple. We mentioned it earlier. No more competition, or at least a very much lack of competition, because pretty much all the therapsids died out. But there are several reasons that might explain why they weren't hit so hard during the extinction event. Diversity is one reason. You guys know from my extinction video that diversity makes a group of organisms less susceptible to extinction because out of all their diverse species, some of those groups might be better adapted to survive certain climate or environmental changes than others. And so diversity is always a great thing for groups of organisms to have in order to survive extinction events. Environmental versatility is another thing. This might sound the same as diversity, but it's not. Even among single species of dinosaurs, they were incredibly, or many of them were incredibly environmentally versatile, meaning that many species of dinosaurs could live in many different environments, and this allowed them to adapt to whatever came their way. The last major reason were their feathers, or feather-like coats. Many therapsids and reptiles couldn't flee from the extreme heat to higher latitudes because they can't survive cold winters. However, early dinosaurs in the Triassic had already developed insulating coats of feathers to access vegetation at higher latitudes, and this allowed them to flee the extreme heat to higher latitudes during the event. But dinosaurs, although they were very successful, weren't the only land animals to survive. Some proto-mammals also made it, obviously, because mammals exist today, and they were likely able to survive because they could burrow to escape the heat. Another group of organisms that we still have today are the crocodiles that also survived likely because they could get into the water to escape the heat. Even though they evolved as terrestrial organisms, they were adapted by the end of the Triassic to at least get in the water if they needed to, even though they weren't fully aquatic. The only completely devastated animals were the ones that were stuck on land above the surface of the land at low latitudes that couldn't escape. So before I end the video, I just wanted to end on a funny anecdote, and that is just that when I searched the end of Triassic extinctions, when I was online just looking for references to use, the first bit of text that like popped up about the Triassic extinction I found so funny that I needed to include it here. And it just says, despite being lesser known, the end Triassic extinction was significant because it paved the way for dinosaurs to rule the Earth so that they could be taken out by an asteroid, thus paving the way for humans to rule the Earth. And in the end, everything else will be taken out by humans, thus paving the way for cockroaches to rule the Earth. I'm sorry, I just had to include it. It's gross and disgusting and scary to think about, but you know what? Cockroaches are pretty dang savvy. So anyway, guys, if you want to check out the major reference I'm using, well, that's the back of it, reference I'm using to make this and other videos in the Earth History playlist, I am using Earth Systems History. This book is linked in my description below. You can also check out some other videos in the playlist, either by clicking the playlist, which should pop up any second now, or one of these videos at the top, like my early Mesozoic land animal video, or my debunking dinosaur myths video, which is kind of like where I talk about why they were so successful, and that one's gonna be good. I haven't filmed yet, but it might be out by the time you're watching this. And anyway, guys, yeah, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye.